You're listening to the Nerd to Know Media Network. Join us at nerdtoknowmedia.com.
Broadcasting from the Blanchistan Center, this is Phoenix FM.
This is 92.5 Phoenix FM, community radio for Dublin 15.
Hey everybody, it's JB Jeremy Borash, and you are listening to Darryl O'Connor on the...
Welcome to the Wrestling Rewind, the only wrestling podcast by fans who don't hate wrestling.
Hello everybody and welcome to Phoenix 92.5 FM. This is The Wrestling Rewind. My name is Darryl O'Connor. Welcome to the show. And with me as always is the one and only, the undefeated 1-0, the real world champion, Mr. Martin Herty. How are you, Martin?
Grand Darryl. I'm sat here with a lovely big glass of lemon and fizzy water because between my sister's wedding and then All In, and then All Out, and then a string of different barbecues and parties along the way, I've been on the lash for about 3 weeks, and that's it. I'm going in honor of, praise Jesus, what'll be our final ever Punk episode, I'm going straight edge.
Really? Forever?
Oh God, no. Probably till Wrestle Dream.
Okay. Because I'm like, I did that for nearly 30 years. It's not fun. Just, you're better off just, you know...
Oh, like, God, no. I do it between, being realistic, I'll do it between AEW pay-per-views.
Okay, well, that's fair. Or until the next drink, and then you're like, oh, here we go, I'll have one, and then
we'll be free. Well, I suppose I have my brother's stag on Halloween, so, yeah.
You will do your best. You'll give it a good college try.
For tonight, I'm straight edge.
That's fair.
Should help you with the old editing process anyway.
Well, there we go. But yeah, we do. Speaking of which, we have an awful lot to get through this week. We have two pay-per-views. We have CM Punk drama and we have a special guest. So it's someone who I wanted on the show for a while. He plays in two bands, including my own, a very good friend of mine, Mr. Cormac Jordan. How are things, sir?
Doing well. In honor of today's episode about Punk, I have a nice alcoholic drink with Coke in it. So screw your Pepsi.
I wouldn't mind, you know, they actually changed Pepsi. I used to really prefer Pepsi, but then they changed the recipe and I can't drink it anymore, so.
You're not accidentally drinking Pepsi Max?
Yeah, it pretty much is Pepsi Max now, because they put, like, sugar and aspartame in it. So it doesn't even taste like Pepsi now. It's weird. So I don't know why they did that, but if I had a Pepsi tattoo, I'd be just as upset as Punk, I'd imagine.
Do you know what I was raging at? Never mind Pepsi and Coke. There's a gorgeous botanical cola called Fentimans, and it mixes amazingly with their bourbon, like mixes perfectly with it. And then they went and fiddled around with the recipe, and yeah, it's rank as well now.
I was in Coke World in Orlando, and it's like this, it's basically like this three-story shop where they have loads of Coke merchandise, and then up on the top they have a Coke bar, right, where you can just get like Coke, Diet Coke, Cherry Coke, whatever. But they have like a sampler, right, where you can, they give you two trays of like a mouthful of each Coke product from around the world. It's like, what, $26. It's 24 drinks. It's pretty cool, right? But some of them are disgusting. And you're like, yeah, I'm never drinking that again. But if you want an experience, guys, that you won't get anywhere else, I recommend that. So on to
got it when you said like you went to Coke World. My first thought was you went to Colombia.
Not that Coke World, Coca-Cola World. But speaking, we are here obviously to talk about wrestling, guys. So let's start off with our favorite topic. So CJ, we have a segment on the show called Bud Punk, right? where Martin will lay out the best scenario in the world. He will be like, you know, book it to a T and what they could do and what they couldn't do and what he's excited for. And then I merely say, but Punk. And then reality hits and it's like, yep.
It'll never happen.
But last week was one of those moments where we were kind of laying out what we thought would happen. You know, we don't really know. There's an investigation. Saturday comes around, right? And it's Payback was on Saturday. News broke that CM Punk had been fired.
Saturday night's all right for firing.
Apparently so, yeah. It was very weird. Collision was on, so it was like 4 hours before Collision in Chicago. Tony got booed.
I stayed up just to watch Collision. Like, I don't normally stay up late to watch the AEW shows, but it's just I had to because I was half expecting the crowd to completely take over the show, just be brutal on Tony and whatnot.
Well, they were, but he came out early,
but they weren't that bad. Well, yeah, here's what they did. Tony had he really had cojones here. He just walked down in front of the crowd before the show, just explained, yep, there's a situation. He got fired. He got really violent. I feared for my life. And panel said, no, we are liable to hell if we keep him. So he's gone.
I think he had to do that because the crowd would have hijacked the entire show. So it was smart. Yeah,
exactly. If it was if it was Vince and WWE, they would have just piped in noise. Nah, yeah. Tony had the balls to do. Said, no, I'm going.
And to be fair to the crowd, like, so he got a good bit of boo. No, he wasn't roundly booed by everyone the way some of the like media groups were treated, but
the video that I saw was from a woman recording it on her phone and she gave him so much abuse.
No, but he did get a good bit of booing. But then see, whenever he was explaining what happened, like whenever he wasn't doing the wrestling shtick, whenever he was like, look, we have like camera guys and boom mic operators and runners, and they all deserve to be able to come to work, you know, in an environment that's, you know, safe and welcoming and where they don't need to feel like nervous or afraid. And like, they actually, the crowd sort of stopped and listened. Like,
well, here's what was kind of silly about that is though, it's like, listen, we've all seen Punk fight, it's embarrassing, right? What was he like? What would he do? Was he flinging with a hockey stick? Was he with a baseball bat? You know, I mean, come on. Like, we've seen him fight. He's really bad.
So, he had Ace Steel on a stick.
There you go. I mean, I'm more afraid of Ace, who also has been fired in like, today.
There was no chance of him staying.
Development.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I don't know. So
How could you keep... Is it mental, the fact that he got brought back, given... Okay, whatever happened with the first brawl out and, you know, Punk apparently threw the first punch. Yeah. He still threw a chair and bit Kenny Omega.
Allegedly.
For legal reasons, allegedly. I just wish they hadn't signed that NDA, because I know the first thing they would have done, a BTE skit where the full moon comes out and Kenny slowly morphs into Ace Steel.
Well,
that would have been brilliant.
The thing about it is, it's like, I do expect like a shoot interview to come out from Ace Steel, because he sacked down, probably wasn't on Punk Bunny, and you know.
I'd say the only reason it took them a week to fire him is they fired Punk like, yeah, pretty much a week ago tomorrow.
Yeah.
Because Ace Steel wasn't allowed to come to the buildings and he was like working from home in inverted commas. I'd say he was just like on the payroll, but like it was just money to keep Punk happy. I'd say they just clean forgot about him. I'd say Tony was running down through, you know, the thing for Collision and he saw, you know, Steele's name on the employee list and he's like, oh my god, we still employ that guy.
The
funniest thing with Ace Steel just before we go is that his real name is Chris Guy. That is the most default name ever. And imagine, like, just
that should have been.
I'm just going, I remember, like, you know, that guy. No, yeah, Chris Guy.
Chris, yeah, that guy.
That guy. No, you're Steel. No, that guy.
So rewinding a little bit, so you know, if you guys haven't heard, because there is like, you know, there was some setup to this. So obviously, just before All In, CM Punk had a fight backstage with Jungle Boy, and this is the result of it. Now, look, last week I mentioned something that upset you a little bit, Martin. I'm gonna say something. Yeah, I'm gonna say something again that's gonna upset you a little bit.
Oh God!
So recently, I discovered the Jim Cornette podcast, right?
Hold on.
CJ, don't you too, right? Listen, I didn't really know what this podcast was beforehand, but I listened to it and I was like, oh.
You sweet sour child, you could have kept it that way.
I agree with a lot of what you said about this. And he said that, you know, at sometimes the bad guys win. And that's what I see here. I mean, look, did Punk go about this the wrong way? Yes. Could things have been a little bit different? Yes. Was firing Punk a good idea? No. I don't think it was the best thing to do because the problems are still there. Now, Cornette goes off a little bit. I think he just really doesn't like AEW, which, I mean...
There was obviously something in the past where he wanted to work for them or he was supposed to work for them.
Yeah, he nearly did. He nearly did. He had like before AEW was fully set up, I think around 2018, he was brought in by Tony Khan and said, I'm setting up a wrestling company. I need some expert advice on this. And the first thing he said to Tony Khan was he saw they're hiring the Elite. And he said, do not hire the Elite. They're shit. Essentially, sorry. And I'll do that one again. He said, don't hire the Elite. They're terrible. They're not good wrestlers. Meanwhile, Tony could see the value in them.
Yeah.
And he recognized, listen, I'm not going to be able to hire Jim Cornette full time if he hates my biggest stars.
Yeah.
And he's constantly getting in trouble for saying really stupid things and like issuing death threats to people. So Jim Cornette knows, he got turned down for the job because he just kept putting his foot in his mouth. And now he keeps playing a character on his podcast that is really angry. So I doubt what he says on his podcast are that the. They're probably close to what he really thinks, but I reckon he does put it on a bit.
Of course, yeah. I mean, like, that is very much what I kind of got from it too. But the take was then mirrored by Vince Russo, which is even more surprising.
Expert wrestling opinion.
Hold on, let me finish what I'm saying. The point is, and then Eric Bischoff, again, it's like, you know, a broken clock is right twice a day. And I think in this case, they are onto something. And look, yes, did he have to fire him from this thing? Fair enough. And the reason why is because there are still issues here with AEW. And I wanted to make this whole show about it because All Out was quite good. And you know, they're able to like limp along and kind of get to where they need to be without Punk and all that kind of stuff. But there's still issues here. And what I'm kind of want to get your thoughts on this. Martin, I'm going to literally go to you in a second. Just one minute. What I wanted to get your thoughts on was with Punk being gone and with this, like, half the issue still finished. And someone else made a go. I think Mark Henry said it. He says, oh, you know, jokingly going, all the drama's gone. Everything will be perfect now. Because obviously it's not going to be because there's still a massive issue. Like, Jungle Boy should be fired, right? He caused this, right? He should be gone, right? But the Elite also shouldn't be the MVP or the EVP, sorry, of this company. They're way too immature, you know, and I don't think they handled it well. The wrestlers, in my opinion, based on everything that we've seen in WCW, everything we've seen in TNA, should not hold positions of power as an active roster. Martin, what do you think about that? Am I off base completely, or can you see where the point of view is coming from?
I would. So there's some I would disagree with, and then some I would say that I wasn't there, so I don't know. So in regards to Jungle Boy, like, the fact that they had the investigation that, you know, was this whole independent thing, that's whatever. What really gets me on the issue between Jungle Boy and Punk and the fight is that Tony Khan fired Punk. Tony Khan, for 2 years, has been in love with Punk. He bent over backwards to get him on the show. He gave him this enormous contract. He hired his lunatic friend after he had like a pew after he publicly disparaged the company and his top stars and his own management and all that in front of him and then had a fight, he still brought him back and gave him his own show and gave him control of that show and rehired his lunatic friend. So, like, I don't think, like, I wasn't there, wasn't at the fight. I don't know what happened. But the one thing that would push me to believe the narrative that Tony Khan's putting out there is that Tony Khan would do anything for Punk. And it must have been completely on the, for Tony Khan to fire Punk, it must have been just totally unavoidable. He must have had zero choice in the situation, because I cannot see him firing Punk at all. If there was any other way around it,
there is an update on this, and it's literally just breaking before we record. So we record on a Friday night, as you guys know. Yeah, literally. So it looks like the Elite or at least the Bucks had a 6 month no Punk drama in their contract.
As in,
if Punk causes stuff, they'll walk or he walks. And that
that's not what they were saying. I think what they're saying is we'll have a sit down talk with Punk to talk and try and resolve these issues between us personally and look into doing a feud on TV if Punk stays out of drama for 6 months.
Yeah.
And I think that's honestly, I think with the Young Buck, I think the kind of narrative going is that Kenny was willing to work with Punk. Any feud with FTR was sorted. The problem was just the Young Bucks didn't want to work with Punk. And everyone's freaking out. I was like, oh, well, you need to sort it out. Yeah, you're unprofessional if you don't. I'm sorry, but the Young Bucks, they nearly had their careers destroyed by Punk. The reports are is that for Brawl Out, they went into his room with the head of legal and head of talent relations, going to their top star's room and say, hey, why are you disparaging the company? Top star throws the first punch. And I don't think any recount disputes that.
Yeah.
And they basically point out, listen, we went in to try and talk this out like EVPs. You punched us and nearly cost our career. Excuse us if we don't want to work with you straight away. We want to see proof that you're not going to destroy the company. And like, listen, you don't head in to start a fight with a lad when you're bringing in your head legal counsel and head of talent relations.
Yeah.
So the fact that they were with them kind of suggests they were willing to go in more professionally. And also, Punk invited him, said, if you have a problem with me, come and see me. Okay, so the heavy VPs of the company come and see their biggest star, who's just been disparaging them around the whole world. Obviously, you're going to go in and try to talk it out with them.
But what I'm saying is, I think that what you just said and what you laid out there was probably a bigger factor as well, where it's like, look, this is going to keep happening. Martin, we joked on the show last week that this is going to happen again, and I probably would have. It probably would have been a consistent thing.
Punk has made it an embarrassment to be an AEW fan for like the last year, and particularly the last few weeks. It's just like every few weeks is, oh God, what the hell is Punk done now?
Can I just say, selfishly, I think it's the best thing ever. But it's a sickness, I think, because it's so TNA-ish that it just, you know, Martin knows this.
Well, look,
I've grown to enjoy the backstage drama, even though it's like proper cancer. I mean,
we're all gossip junkies. We all love a little bit of gossip. It's a little fun to get that bill behind the scenes look. But the fact that, you know, just what he was doing was just, oh, for God's sake, you're just going to make it worse.
Yeah.
Like the fact that he just couldn't get over Hangman.
Yeah.
Or meanwhile, Hangman is saying nothing.
Exactly.
But here's what it is for me. I love pints, right? Pints are great. And like I said at the start of the show, I spent the last 3 goddamn weeks in the pints. And now I'm sick of them. And just like that, I was the same as yourselves. Love the sort of backstage locker room politics, the rumblings, the stories from the dirt sheets. Love all that. And then Punk came in. And then we got to gorge on that stuff for 2 solid years. Like for 2 years, that overtook any of the actual wrestling, any of the actual shows, any of that. And see with Punk out of the way, like I didn't want to see him go. I'm a huge CM Punk fan. I thought his promos were great, his storylines, his matches, he could still go. Like my ideal scenario would have been the bloody sit down and sort it out. But with him gone, it does feel like we've gorged on this backstage drama and all that for long enough now. And now we can stop for a while. And now we can concentrate on the shows. And now we can concentrate on the wrestling. And for me, All Out was the perfect embodiment of that. All Out felt like I know we're not going into it yet, but overall for me, All Out felt like 2019, 2020 AEW. It felt like really a return to the company's roots.
Yeah, and I think a lot of what has happened this week with the brand split pretty much being done away with the Elite showing up on Collision, which was very weird. You know, these kind of things, and then the firings, it seems like they're going for, you know, as you said, a return back to 2019.
And I hope Collision doesn't lose its like unique identity.
I like Collision. I like a different feel.
It still needs to feel different from Dynamite. Like, but yeah, I'm glad to see the end of the roster split.
It feels more like a classic, and I don't mean this in a disparaging way. It feels like a classic WCW show. That's what Collision feels like. Dynamite feels like an indie show that has money. That's not a dig either. That's what it feels like. You know,
here's what I've heard about so many times about Collision is that it's AEW, but for the people who don't like AEW,
which is why I like it.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much. Yeah, it's just that, it has that slightly different feel to it. That, you know, listen, Dynamite, I love how. No, it was a very experimental sort of wrestling show compared to WWE, and that's why I love it so much.
Yeah,
but like you can see the more kind of classic old school flavor in Collision.
Yeah,
and I actually do like that.
It's like the closest thing you can have to like peak Nitro, and it's like this is actually really cool. So I hope that doesn't go away. And I think having Daniel Bryan there would be like super. What's his name? The American
call him by
Bryan. Bryan Danielson.
You call him by his real name, you bolt. I'm not going to say the rest of it.
So having him there kind of taking over the CM Punk role is quite good. But listen, I have a comment and I have a question before we move on from this, because we are going to move on in the interest of time. So the comment I have is when I got back from, well, after all of our journeys back from All In, because Martin got stuck in England for like
3 days.
Me and CJ ended up on the same flight back on the same day after me getting like a rail ticket and be like, I'm going to sail home. So we all got back, and the minute I got home, I was like, right, I'm going to order a CM Punk action figure from Amazon. Right. So between me ordering it on the Monday and it arriving, Punk had been fired. I couldn't believe it. I was like, you can't make it up. It arrived on the Saturday and he was fired like 2 hours later. It was hilarious.
But that's actually kind of perfect. So you've got that, and you were at Punk's possibly last ever match live.
Yeah, I mean,
I think there's a highly likelihood that's probably going to be him with wrestling. Like, so, okay, WWE, so, I doubt it.
Okay, so don't jump ahead, my question. Remember, don't jump ahead. So the next question is coming up, right? So CJ, because you kind of, I'm going to go to you first. So listen, right? He's done with AEW, right? That's it. The door is finished. WWE Survivor Series is in Chicago. The Royal Rumble is in Chicago. It's a big possibility, right? I know they want them back, but he has a lot of bridges to mend. There is a third option, right? And I think it's a very, very real option if he wants to. Now, they normally can't afford him, but they might do it. And apparently some talent are excited. What's the possibility? And again, CJ, I'm going to go to you first. Of CM Punk showing up at Impact.
I really doubt it. It's not, I don't think it's a money issue so much. I reckon if it became a money issue, if Punk really wanted to do Impact, they could sort something out. They could get a loan. He could take a cut, whatever. I think it's an ego thing, because he's not going to want to show up to basically a tiny arenas. And I don't know if him just by himself could push them from like small venues taped in the same venue over and over again to suddenly a huge touring entity.
Well, no, I mean, I don't think that's what he'd want either. I think it's more a case of that level of control, because it looks like the contract that Punk had there wasn't just one. It wasn't just one contract. It was like two or three, because he had a performance one, and he basically was an EVP as well, or similar to it. You know, by the wording again, we don't know that yet, but it looks like that was the case. I'd imagine Impact would probably give him something similar, like complete creative control or something like that. And, you know, that's what would probably bring him back. Do you not think that would do it, no?
I don't think it's a creative thing so much. I think he knows his value in that he is the one who brings in, you know, pushes a company from like 3,000 a night to 10,000 a night when he gets a chance. I don't think he's willing to go to Impact because they're such a small company, and even with him, he wouldn't push up the numbers that much. I don't think he knows it's not good for his image if he's going from the star of the second biggest promotion, the first serious competition in WWE, to Impact, which is basically a glorified indie.
What about WWE?
I would really doubt it, but I you never say never in wrestling.
Okay.
But it's like, it's just like, you know, obviously there's reports that him and H don't get along, but then again, he showed up to WWE like a few months ago just to try and mend some bridges. So who knows? But I just, it doesn't, it would, if he did, it wouldn't be for money. He seems money wise, he's fine. It would be out of complete spite.
Martin, what about you?
So Impact, just not a chance. Like, I just don't see that happening at all. His last match was in front of the biggest wrestling crowd in history, and then his next one, you know, isn't going to be in, you know, Reading Town Hall or whatever. Like,
hold on, this Impact disparaging is not cool.
It's a great show.
An English tour? One of the shows is in Reading.
Come on. Like, let's
be, I mean, listen, we all, I think Impact deserves some respect for like having probably the better women's division in North America, but let's be realistic here. It's like a couple hundred people per taping. It's like, it's not even like a touring live thing. They literally just tape at the same studio a couple shows at a time.
They do their best.
So, without being disparaging of Impact, and like you say, it's always good to have alternatives and rival companies in wrestling. So, not being disparaging of Impact, I don't see him going there.
Yeah.
There was talk that maybe he might go to Japan, but then I remember
Journey's because AEW and New Japan,
exactly. So they have that relationship. But then there's like other companies in Japan, like All Japan and that. But then again,
DDT,
match.
I imagine him in DDT. Kenny's kind of homegrown promotion, DDT, where they do all the crazy, silly stuff. Iron Fist to make it serious.
Not even any like specific Japanese promotion. After his match with, I think it was the House of Black, he was like complaining that they were chopping him too hard. Mm. And if you don't like getting chopped, Japan is not the country for you. So I don't see him going there. WWE, I actually agree with CJ that he would go like purely out of spite. He is a man motivated by spite.
He is, yeah.
The problem is, I don't think WWE would take him. They'll be looking at all the problems he caused. They'll be looking at all the issues he has with people currently in WWE. They'll be looking at what Tony did. Like he can come in and say, oh, I'll mend all these bridges. But then they'll be looking at what Tony did to keep him happy, and even that didn't keep him happy. But ultimately, I think the thing that'll keep him out of WWE is they're doing fine.
Mm.
They don't need Punk, you know? Like, for the first time in a long time, that company seems to be doing at least some sort of long-term booking. So I don't see them taking a gamble when their ratings are already through the roof, their sales are through the roof, they're making more money than they've ever made, their pay-per-views are on Peacock now, so they're getting bigger audiences than ever. They don't need Punk. Why would you take a gamble on him? But I would say, would be absolutely hilarious if he pops up in the Royal Rumble and takes Cody's spot at WrestleMania. I would possibly day laughing.
And with that, guys...
Also, it's worth remembering, both the male world champions, Roman Reigns, Seth Rollins, do not like Punk.
No.
They've made it very clear they don't like him. And if both your champions are saying, No, we don't want him back. Particularly Roman Reigns was like crazy power there. They're not going to have him.
Well, I think in a couple of, it'll probably take a couple of years because you know how long it takes him to calm down. I think he will stop and look back and go, I really screwed up there.
But look, we'll leave that on the final word with Punk for the time being. Guys, we're going to take a quick break here and then come back, go into Payback, then into All Out. This is the Wrestling Rewind. We'll talk to you in a few minutes after this short break. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the show, of course, here on Phoenix 92.5 FM, TheWrestlingRewind.com, Nerd to Know Media, and wherever else podcasts are available. Thank you so much for joining us. If this is your first time checking us out, again, we appreciate it. Go over to the podcast feed. There's something like 180 shows or something, Martin. We're really getting up there now. So
we're firing up there.
And if you want to help the show out, again, the best way is just spread the podcast around. But we also have a Patreon, and you can give us an X-Pac Euro where you can keep the lights on and the tiers go up from there as well. Martin, would you like to tell the good people about the tiers that we have today?
We do. We have our X-Pac Euro. That's exclusively for those who didn't know that at the start of the song, X-Pac is shouting, make some noise, and not sex-Pac, which most people seem to think it was. So if you weren't aware of that, you owe us an X-Pac Euro. That's not negotiable. That's not a donation or anything. If you didn't know that, you owe that to us.
Automatically.
If you want to be really generous, you can send us a Virgil tenner. And starting this week, we're doing our new CM Punk penny. So you send us a penny every day until Punk shows up on some other wrestling program.
That's totally fair. It's totally fair. We should put in like an A Steel Fiver.
Yeah.
So he doesn't buy people?
Yeah, allegedly? Yeah. So it'll be like protection money. It's an ace steel mouth guard. For every fiver you send us, we will post a gum shield to ace steel.
Or even better, it will protect Kenny Omega from turning into a steel aerial full moon.
That's true. Kenny Omega silver.
A full moon fiver.
A full moon. Well, hold on. If you turn into a werewolf, silver kills werewolves.
So he's not turning into a werewolf, he's turning into a steel.
Oh, that's true.
Kenny only wins gold. Don't worry about it.
But yeah, guys, you can go over to the Patreon now and we would appreciate any way to support us because, you know, why not? Come on, what else are you doing? Anyway, so we're going to move on and talk about Payback, which was on the same time as Collision. So at one point I had Collision on one screen and then I had Payback on the other screen. Then I got bored about Collision because Punk wasn't there and turned it off. So then I watched Payback.
That's not fair because he didn't show up on Payback either.
I know, but I mean, I wasn't watching the show with the expectation that he was going to show up.
You shouldn't have been watching Collision with the expectation that he was going to show up.
I thought it was a work.
Well, I'll tell
how
you what.
Do you think it was a work and they're giving out his full shoot name?
Well, to be
AEW is not that insane.
I was convinced for weeks that Brawl Out was a work, that it was genius, setting up all these feuds, I was fully convinced. But yeah, I'm totally reformed now and I'm happy to say that
everyone look terrible.
But here's the thing. If Fire and Punk before Collision was a work, it would be genius as well. But look, we're not going to get into that because we've just rid ourselves of Punk on this podcast for a while.
Fine.
Let's leave him in the other segment. Okay,
you're going to have to come up with some sort of new intro for me because this 1-0 thing is done. Punk's out of here. We're not after this episode. We're not mentioning his name.
But you're always 1-0. That's your legitimate MMA record.
Nah, I suppose, yeah.
I mean, that's legit.
And if Punk can't be the real world champion, we're going to need another real world champion.
Exactly, Martin. Come on.
All right, I'll be your
you
champion.
You have to. You've been outvoted.
I'll spray the X on your face.
Okay. So, look, this show, I know Martin wasn't thrilled by it. I haven't had a chance to talk to you yet, Cormac, about it. I guess we'll kind of do it this way. We'll go match by match and then see what we thought about it overall. We don't have to like dig too deep into it. There's only six matches. It was actually like a very quick show, which genuinely I was actually really appreciative of, because there was so much wrestling over the past couple of weeks. I was like, I just want a nice tight show. So much better than others. I thought everything kind of made sense. The main event was super good. It was bookended by two really good matches, in my opinion. I really liked the Cage match, and I really, really liked the main event. But we'll do it this way first, right? So the show opened up with Becky Lynch versus Trish Stratus. Obviously, you know, the whole feud has been that Trish is supposed to be the, you know, she's the most, the best definition of women's wrestling in history. And she's going against Becky, obviously, who's the modern day face of women's wrestling for a lot of people. I really like this match. It's weird to see a cage match that is done this well in modern wrestling, but also this felt very 2000-y. Like it helped having Trish Stratus there, but when I was watching it, I was like, whoa, even a lot of the spots in this were very reminiscent of something you'd see on Raw in 2001. Becky looked great, Trish looked great, the match itself, yeah, the ending was a bit screwy, but again, that makes sense because the Attitude Era was a mess. Even though we love it, still a total mess. But they're my thoughts on it. I thought Becky winning made the most sense, and then the little turn as well. So CJ, what did you think about this one?
Well, first of all, I think the whole stipulation of first to escape the cage is really stupid.
Yeah,
the idea of, yeah, no, the whole concept of the cage match is when you have the heel who's constantly running away and looking for some sort of escape, the cage stops them doing that so they can finally settle it. But then the stipulation is, oh, well, if they can escape, then they win. That's really dumb. I think cage matches kind of lose something when you don't have the roof on it, and also when you don't have a little bit of blood in the match. I know WWE doesn't want that anymore, but I don't know. When you get like a really personal, really, really angry feud, I think just a little bit of blood makes it something. But yeah, no, they did look good in it. Yeah, I think obviously right call having Becky go over. I don't think it was too screwy. I mean, it kind of makes sense having your one run in to try and interfere a bit in the match. At the end of the day, yeah, I think the ending was good. And yeah, it's good to see cage matches. Just yeah, need a bit more violent.
That's true. That's a fair comment. I like the current cage to use. It's kind of like a throwback to the Attitude Era as well, which is nice.
Nice that it's not red.
Yeah, the red cage is terrible. Don't know who came up with that, but always looks bad. Martin, you weren't necessarily a fan of this one or the show in general.
No, but so, look, I'm willing to, on this match in particular, I'm willing to take to defer to sort of public opinion on it. Like, everything I've seen, it seems to be universally loved, this match. I don't know if it's maybe just WWE's presentation style or what it is, but I found it, I thought it was okay. I found it a wee bit stilted. I thought, you know, there was the Becky and Trish were quite awkward in certain spots. I don't know what it is. I was genuinely surprised when I saw that the consensus is that this is an incredible match. So I'm willing to say, I don't know, maybe I was in a
bad
mood
that.
Or something.
Yeah, no, I agree on that. It was okay match. I wouldn't say it was like absolutely incredible, but it was just like, I watched, it was like, yeah, this is like an acceptable cage match to end a feud.
Yeah, but what I mean is, like, it wasn't the best cage match of all time, obviously. But for the women's division, on, you know, opening up the show this strongly, or even, you know, WWE opening up the show strongly in general, it's nice to see. And I just kind of liked a lot of the, I think what hooked a lot of people here, and particularly me as well, is that it didn't feel like a modern WWE show. It felt like walking in time machine. They used a lot of Trish's history in it, and this is probably the best that Trish has ever looked. You know, I mean,
great way to go out,
absolutely. And that's kind of what I think they were doing here. They really wanted to give her something to leave on, you know. And Becky's great, obviously. Trish is phenomenal. This is probably one of the best cage matches I've seen in recent times in WWE, and probably the best cage match that I've ever seen involving two women. who, you know, a bit of blood would have been great. A bit more violence would have been great. But again, you know, Cage match is violent enough. But yeah, I'll give you guys that.
I think it's good just because you're taking a wrestler who, you know, primarily worked in the Divas area where they weren't given really the respect they deserved. They had to do all these, you know, kind of degrading matches with bra and panty sort of stipulations and not that much time. It's good to see Trish come out and say, hey, listen, I can work. I can really put on a good match if you just give me the time and just give me the sort of respect I deserve. And it's good that there's still some Divas who can still work at that sort of level and get the appreciation they deserve.
Well, you know, that it's good that they kind of have that, you know, opportunity now. But we moved on then to a John Cena appearance and a lot of speculation why Cena's here. Apparently, it's got a lot to do with the fact that Hollywood is kind of shut down for a little while.
That's the entire reason why.
Yeah, so he's just like, oh, I might as well go and wrestle. So he shows up, and it looks like he's going to be around for a little while, which is kind of cool. It's a good presence to be there. He was there to put over LA Knight, which, I mean, obviously LA Knight is probably one of the best things in wrestling right now, particularly in WWE. And LA Knight defeated The Miz via pinfall, with John Cena serving as the special guest referee. It was a longer match than expected. I really don't think it needed to be nearly 16 minutes. It could have been 4, and that would have been fine. But this was more to get over that LA Knight is kind of that Rocket Pack is firmly on his back and he is going to the moon. What did you guys think about this, Martin? LA Knight?
So firstly, the big 20-minute Cena promo thing, like, I think this was part of my issue with this pay-per-view as a whole. Like, you had this, and then you had another one of these later on with Cody, a big long interview segment. And these are things you put on Raw, you know, in the middle of a pay-per-view. This just felt like an awful lot of padding. It broke up the whole momentum of the show. But that's kind of like when you view it as a whole. The match itself was fine. It was a Miz match. It was a 16-minute Miz match. It really didn't need to be 16 minutes. But
the Miz and long matches is the worst thing ever.
Oh my god. But LA Knight's, he's over as hell, and I don't know, in order to get up the ladder in WWE, you have to serve your time with the Miz. So he's
the gatekeeper for some reason.
Yeah, he's done it. He's out the other side. I wish him all the best. But this didn't particularly do anything for me.
CJ, you got anything to add on that one?
I'm just kind of big agreement. It's just like these promo bits just kill the pace of a pay-per-view. Like, pay-per-views, you shouldn't have those long sort of promos. It's all, to me, it's all about the matches. And the match, it's just like, just watching, it just did nothing for me. Just like, okay. Like, LA Knight, he is crazy over. Like, just walking around the streets, it would not be totally uncommon just hear a random, yeah.
Literally,
just like, it's amazing. Like, I'm all in. Constantly, it was like the totally opposite company, but still everywhere. Yeah,
no, literally, it's amazing. So on the feed now, there's like the show we did when I went to WWE Live in Dublin. Right, I was not a fan of LA. I was nothing to LA Knight. I really did nothing for me. Right, over the course of those 3 hours, solely just from that, and when he came out, absolutely a believer. He's so over. And it is just right place, right time, right catchphrase. Come on. Like, I mean,
yeah.
Same with you. In All In, there were people always, yeah. And even in the airport, I don't think you heard that on the airport. There were some people doing it too. So,
yeah, I heard that as well. But like, yeah, it's like, why put him against The Miz? It's like, you give him a really good hot feud. And like, but it does show to the talent of LA Knight that every crap feud he gets put into, he still turns it to gold. Like Bray Wyatt, like, that was a weird feud and he still came out of it looking amazing. Mm-hmm. They just do nothing with him. He comes out looking amazing, loses Money in the Bank, comes out looking amazing. Now they have him working with, I think, to borrow a line from MJF, a car wrestler. And for, if you don't know that reference, it's creator wrestler, you default creator wrestler. And that's what Miles Vince feels like. He feels like just something default in a video game, create a wrestler mode. And yeah, it's just like, it's just, there's no point to this feud. And it's just like, come on, you could do better with him. Give him something to really sink his teeth into.
Well, I mean, I think he did. Like, he got that with Bray Wyatt in the Royal Rumble.
Yeah, that's what I'm sort of saying. He did get like a decent feud. It was just a little weird, and the match itself wasn't amazing. Stunning visuals, weird ending, but the fact that he still managed to come out of it looking really good. Just the fact that fans were just so interested in this LA Knight character shows that. If you give LA Knight something, he'll make it work. So give him something really goddamn good.
I think we're going to see that. And having seen it there as the passing of the torch kind of thing, that really was the point of this. It did the job. You know, I expect him to go up the card now and we'll kind of see what happens. But the next match was very weird. It was like the opposite. Rey Mysterio, for some reason, beating Austin Theory with the US title on the line. I don't think Mysterio needs this. I know it's a whole LWO thing, but it's like, come on, Mysterio, like, why? What are you doing? This
was like something that should have just appeared on a random Raw.
Yeah, this felt like a Raw segment to me. There was nothing cool about it. The match itself was bleh. It was strange. I think you hit the nail on the head. It felt like a Raw segment. Martin?
Yeah, I mean, all the respect in the world for Rey Mysterio, but you put him up against Austin Theory. It's a bit like sticking LA Knight up against The Miz. Like, these are guys who are non-entities. They really need to go away and come back totally, totally reinvented, because they just scream like Raw mid-card. So the match, again, did nothing for me. Like, we're three matches in at this stage. We've been through a 20-minute talkie segment, and I'm really just starting to lose the will to live at this stage. But do you know what? That's hyperbolic. That's too much. Do you know what it was? At this stage, the pay-per-view, because it's an amazing last match, I can't wait to talk about it, but right up until that point, the pay-per-view has given me mad, like, mid-2010s split roster pay-per-view. Do you know the way you used to get like a Roadblock or a Great Balls of Fire that was like only Raw or only SmackDown, and it was like the stars would have like one big match and then it was just a bunch of filler? That's the vibe I was getting off this pay-per-view, as I say, right up until the main event.
Yeah,
oh,
I mean,
yeah, I agree that.
I would agree with that as well. I think that was very fair. It did have more moments though than those split roster shows. I would have to say, the fact that you had the torch passing moment, and then you also had the undisputed title tag title's been changed, which I don't think anybody saw coming. I definitely didn't. I was very surprised by that. They're two moments that genuinely on 2005 pay-per-view or split roster pay-per-view around the time, you wouldn't really see that. It would always be status quo. So, I mean, if nothing else, we got two big changes here, I think, which I think justifies the show. Now, it wasn't the best show in the world, but I did really enjoy that we had those moments that, you know, I wasn't expecting.
Yeah, and look, like, sure, sometimes you would get those kind of shocks with those split roster pay-per-views. Do you remember one of the Cyber Sundays we did? They came out and was it Shelton Benjamin beat Chris Jericho for the Intercontinental title? And you were like, what the hell?
Yeah, exactly. And they didn't even know that was happening until they were walking out. Like,
I'm fully aware that I'm the AEW guy, so I try not to sound like I'm just like being down on this stuff just to be down on it. I'm honestly not. But yeah, again, this far into the pay-per-view, I was really flagging.
Yeah, like I'm kind of the same. I'm more AEW than WWE, but yeah, those the LA Knight match, the Rey Mysterio match, just watch going like, why am I watching this? This feels so unneeded. And this doesn't feel like a pay-per-view worthy match.
Okay. Well, look, we'll move along on the next. We'll combine the next two matches then and move to what really kind of held the show together. Judgment Day defeated Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn. Again, I was just kind of semi watching this because, you know, Sami Zayn's there, and I just so I was happy enough when Finn won, because I'm like, yay. Obviously Finn Balor, who's Irish, you know, we need to get the wins in. Yeah, exactly. So I was happy for them, and also
JD McDonagh got the help.
Yeah, exactly. And
Wolf Tones need to do a Finn Balor song.
He should. A clash.
In fact, it's one of his finishing moves called 1916.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. Writes itself.
Have them there walking him out to WrestleMania. I think that'd be class. Yeah, so
RTE would just implode.
But he might actually pay attention to wrestling, so that would be cool.
Yeah, but they just give out about it.
Oh, well, look, leave them to it.
Poor Bray lad has been corrupted by Americans to kicking people's heads in, stomping on them from great height to the tune of Sinn Féin music.
While wearing loads of different kinds of paint. It writes itself. But yeah, so again, I'm always happy to see Sami Zayn lose, so I was thrilled.
You monster.
No, man, come on. I just don't get it. Rhea Ripley.
You don't like Sami Zayn?
No, it's his music. It drives me up the wall.
Oh, right.
Like, if he changes music, here's the thing. I think I've said this before, right? Here's how you fix Sami Zayn, right? Change his music, right? Maybe to something like Motorhead. You know, he grows his hair out a little bit. Maybe you give him like an accessory, like a hammer. Change up his moveset maybe to like good moves, like, you know, something like a pedigree, and you know, there you go. Get my leather jacket.
Yeah, gain 30 kilos of muscle.
Yeah, I mean, there you go.
You literally just want to turn Sami Zayn into Triple H. is that your trick for every wrestler? Is you turn him into Triple H?
It'll get them over. You know, that's the thing. Get them over.
Well, it's Sami Zayn who's not over whatsoever.
To me, anyway. To me. It'll get them over to me. No, it could be wrong, but that's what I would do to fix Sami Zayn. Or put the mask back on him. That'd be good, too. Just saying.
Mask. Will he ever wear a mask? I don't think Sami Zayn's ever worn a mask.
Well, Sami Zayn didn't, but El Generico did. So,
and why are we talking about El Generico? He's a very different person. He's retired and moved out to Mexico now.
Of course, how silly. How silly of me.
Next he'll be throwing around salacious rumors about the true identity of Mr. America.
Oh, come on now. We're not this kind of show. but look, Rhea Ripley was successful in her defense, which again is great. I love Rhea Ripley. I always have a fear that Charlotte Flair is going to walk out and beat her like every week. That's just going to happen. Like every time she comes out, she's like, hey, oh no. And you know, okay, yeah, Grant,
I think we're free from Charlotte Flair.
We're never free from Charlotte Flair, man.
Apparently, the reason why is, I think it's twofold. One, apparently, she's doing a bodybuilding competition, so she needs time off to get the body ready for that. And two, word is her and Andrade are getting divorced and they're dealing with that. So, yeah. So, real life reasons.
But who knows? Like Triple H might go, Jesus, Charlotte's having a tough old time with this divorce. Do you know what would really cheer her up?
Breaking her dad's record.
If we got her to break her dad's world title record.
Oh, man. Like every time there's like a woman wrestler who like is getting a break, I just expect it. It's just like you're just sitting there like, oh, Charlotte's running. She's running through a gorilla.
Darby's sitting in the kitchen in the morning and his ma comes up and puts the kettle on. She's just about to take a sip of a lovely cup of tea, and Dara's just sitting there terrified that Charlotte's going to come bursting through the door and take the tea off her.
I mean, come on, man. It happens all the time. It's just like, oh, this... I just... That woman, her best performance was in WCW that one time. Remember, Martin?
Yeah.
So look, in the 8 minutes we have... Well, 6 minutes we have left before we have to take a break, before we jump over into the podcast. What did we think about the main event, Martin?
Right. This was, felt like a totally different show for the last 30 minutes. The presentation of Shinsuke Nakamura was amazing. I don't know what they've been doing with Nakamura for the past, 5 years he's been there or whatever, but this is what Shinsuke Nakamura should be. That kind of samurai manga intro.
Oh,
they had
so
for
good.
Him. Yeah, oh, God, amazing. I love that.
Incredible.
Loved it.
His entrance for the first time since he debuted, his entrance wasn't this goofy fella, you know, in a cat suit coming out. He legitimately looked dangerous. He looked like a guy who was ready for the world title. He got in and he fought like Nakamura. He fought almost like, you know, New Japan Nakamura.
I got that too. Yeah, this felt like a Wrestle Kingdom match.
That's not that hard, but
but you know what I mean. It's WWE in their best Wrestle Kingdom.
It's the, you know, WWE version. But I'm telling you, the last half hour of this show felt like a completely different pay per view. I think that's maybe why a lot of people are sort of given a lot of goodwill. I think maybe more than it deserves, because the last half hour kind of left you feeling great. Wow, that was
the last bit of like the last let's say segment of the match was actually probably one of the best things I've seen in WWE in a long time.
You know, it was
actually fantastic.
And the match was built really well. Like a lot of times, because WWE have their house style, like when a match goes half an hour, there's a big plodding section in the middle or like a really slow start. But no, this was built really well and paced really well.
Mm.
And it peaked at certain times and got into like a genuine frenzy by the end, where you knew in the back of your mind, like, Rollins isn't dropping the title this early, and he's not dropping it to Shinsuke Nakamura. Like, he looks great here, but they've done nothing with him for however many years. But man, you were watching those shoulders go down for a couple of those counts, and you were thinking, oh my God, they're going to do it.
Yeah.
This was excellent.
CJ?
I would say, yeah, it was a damn good match, and I love what they're making Shinsuke feel like a really legitimate challenge. I would disagree, though, with the idea of, oh, maybe they're finally changing. Nah, to me, it was never in question. Like, and that's one of the things that did sour the match a tiny bit for me, is that when it's a pay-per-view world title defense, to me, to be good, it needs to feel like a legitimate challenge. And as much as I loved Nakamura, I didn't feel like it was a serious challenge. Like, I knew at the end, of course, it's going to be Rollins coming out at the end.
Okay.
I know kind of feelings that it was going to be either way. And that kind of sours the match a little bit for me, because then I just feel like, okay, it's just a question of how Rollins is going to do it.
And that's fair. I mean, look, I think the last word on this show really is, you know, it is bookended by two really, really good shows. Can you skip everything else? Yeah, probably. But I'd say if you haven't seen the Nakamura-Rollins match, probably go out of your way to watch it. Guys, we're going to jump over.
We skipped right over a 20-minute Cody talking segment as
no,
well.
We didn't. No, we didn't.
You must have fell asleep and dreamt that, Martin.
We briefly chatted about why we had like two talking segments, and really, let's just skip over it, because talk promos in a pay-per-view usually waste time.
Yeah, and that's what it felt like. But we're going to jump over onto the podcast, where it's going to be all things All Out. Again, if this is your first time checking out the show, thank you so much for checking us out on Phoenix 92.5 FM. We're here every week. But please go over to nerdtoknowmedia.com or thewrestlingrewind.com, where you can get all of our shows, including the rest of this one, because we're going to be back after this break talking about AEW's All Out.
You have nothing else to do on a Saturday? Do you like nerd things? Now check out Nerd to Know Basis here on Phoenix 92.5 FM, 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. And then head over to nerdtoknowmedia.com for all of our shows as part of the Nerd to Know Media Radio Network.
Thank you for listening to a Nerd to Know Media production.
Look out, there goes
Hey everybody, welcome back to The Wrestling Rewind here on Phoenix 92.5 FM's post show. TheWrestlingRewind.com, The True Penny Channel, and NerdToKnowMedia.com. This show is obviously what we do after the radio show, and now it's going to be all about AEW's All Out, the second pay-per-view, which they did in the space of 2 weeks. Of course, the first one being All in London, which myself, my co-host, and our guest were all at. And now this one was from Chicago, which didn't have CM Punk on it. So that was hilarious that all went down. But we talked about that in the earlier segment. If you guys haven't checked that out, go over and listen to it. But we had a stack card tonight. I know Martin's chomping at the bit to talk about this. We're not going to talk about the pre-show. We're just going to keep it nice and tight, starting from the Ring of Honor World Tag Team Championships all the way down. So before we get into this, guys, what were your expectations before watching this show? I know, like, for myself, I didn't really have any. I was kind of like, okay, really looking forward to seeing the strap match, but I didn't really know what to expect, because again, like, it was kind of a case of, right, All In was very good, if not great. How are they going to do it again? What was it going to feel like? Was something going to be lacking? Blah, blah, blah. There's some of the concerns I had, but after watching it, I think a lot of those were either completely void or my expectations were exceeded. But Martin, you said this is like the best show you've ever seen. Why?
This is my, not the best show I've ever seen, but for me, this is my show of the year.
Okay.
Maybe very, very close run with Forbidden Door, but I think AEW is a wee bit like Armagh's county football team. They can go out, do all the training, do the best, you know, be put in the best position in the world and go out and face, you know, a lower league team and get beat. But when they're under pressure, when they're in trouble, and when they're coming up against a team everyone says they're going to be battered by, they somehow managed to pull out a win. So All Out had everything running against it. Its build was muddled because the biggest show in history happened a week before it, and the build was kind of half for it, and then a couple of things were nodded towards All Out. A couple of things were thrown on in the final Dynamite and final Collision, so it didn't feel like there was a whole load of long run stuff going into it. And then, of course, like days before it happens, the man who was supposed to main event the show was fired.
Yeah.
So it felt like this show had everything going against it. But I don't know what it is, and I'm looking forward to the next couple of weeks of Dynamite and Revolution to see if I can pinpoint what exactly it was, because it's not just getting rid of Punk, although that is a big part of it. I think that has sort of relieved a lot of tension in the locker room. But whatever it was, from the minute this show started, like even before the first match, it just felt like, oh, the old AEW again. It felt like 2019, 2020, sort of pre-pandemic AEW. Like, it felt gritty, visceral. It felt like a fight night. It didn't have, you know, 80, 90,000 people there, but the 10,000 people who were there were absolutely rabid because of the smaller arena. They were closer in, and it felt like everyone on the card, you know, what they did with the original All In and what they did with the sort of the first year of AEW when there was a lot of guys people didn't know, it felt like everyone on this card had something to prove. I don't know what it is. It's just like, maybe if we go through it match for match, I'll go, actually, maybe Forbidden Door match for match was better. But I think there's a difference between best pay-per-view and your favorite pay-per-view. So I'll say this is my, if not the best pay-per-view of the year, probably my favorite pay-per-view of the year.
That's fair. And CJ, what about you? What were your thoughts going into this? What were your concerns? Were they met, or were you disappointed?
The concerns were kind of the same, in that it felt like when you're doing two shows in a row, and Tony, he actually has some pretty decent reasoning for why he did that. Because obviously he got the bank holiday in the weekend in the UK, and then a week later it's the bank holiday weekend in the US. So it made sense from a business perspective. But yeah, it's just like, it felt like most of the build went to All In, and justifiably so, but it just felt like All Out got maybe the scraps, or would then be sorted out the week after. But then the week after you have people missing it because of like storms, injuries. I think there was a funeral for Wyndham Rotunda as well. It's kind of scumpered plans as well. But here's what I always say with AEW. Even if the build sucks, even if there's so much tension or whatever going before, utter nonsense, you tell the talent, go out there, kill it. All the wrestlers in AEW, I feel, particularly the ones in pay-per-view, are hungry. And I love it when a performer is hungry.
The only
thing to destroy.
The only thing that bugged me about this was the lack of build. You know, and look.
Yeah.
And the only reason why, look what you're saying, you guys are right. You're not wrong. Bodies have made really good points, which I agree with. The actual wrestling itself stands to itself, right? But at the end of the day, this is a pro wrestling company, right? And they're supposed to tell stories, pal. And they're not. Like, I mean, you can't build something in a week, you know? And look,
obviously, well, here's the thing. Well, a lot of these are decent long-term stories, though.
Yeah, but hold on. What I'm saying is, like, I'm going to give the strap match a pass because obviously that was set up probably day of, right? Danny Bryan returned in, like, you know, earlier than expected, and you know, he did a great, and I really like the Ricky Dragon Steamboat segment. That was class, right? So we give that one a pass. But a lot of these matches, while they were part of long-term stories, they didn't have that big, it didn't feel like it had a sense of finish. Like Moxley and Orange Cassidy was incredible, but it was random. It was very random, and I just wish these matches were set up. Look, there's how many pay-per-views do AEW have?
Normally, it takes about prior to 2022, it was like 4 a year.
Okay.
Last year was 5. This year, they're really picking them up because the network has said they want more pay-per-views.
So look, if they are going to go to one a month,
oh this God, kind of, no.
Yeah, no, but this kind of stuff,
I think
is
Gates all, pushing it, but yeah.
Yeah, but okay, if they go one a month, this kind of build is okay. Even at 8, they should be 2 or 3 months out. You know, like every one of these, but like particularly All Out and All In, they're their biggest shows, right? They're the shows that they, you know, they're kind of like, it's kind of like the Starrcade or whatever, right? Or the Bound for Glory. This stuff should matter, and it just didn't really seem to matter outside of the match being awesome. It didn't seem to matter, and that's something they need to kind of work on. Like, I mean, okay, what I mean by that is, the Daniel Bryan Ricky Starks match, right? The only reason why that mattered was because it was a strap match and two lads killed each other, right? But when I was watching it, I was like, but why are you so angry at him? Like, you weren't even involved in a week.
I think if you watched AEW a bit more long term, a week on week, a lot more, these matches make sense to you.
Yeah.
Why they really work so well.
Well, okay. Why did Moxley and Orange Cassidy have to be so violent towards each other for a title that Cassidy was kind of, you know, his whole thing was he didn't really care about it. You know, why was that match so violent?
Oh, no, that's absolutely not what's happening with Orange Cassidy. Orange Cassidy, you make it clear, he just got it from the start because he wanted to beat a pack. And right. Then when he got it, he's been ruthlessly defending it. He's made it clear, this is my title. I'm going to defend it like hell. He's become the workhorse of AEW now, Orange Cassidy. And that title reign has been elevated, that title from something we give Pac to defend on the indies to the real workhorse champion.
But why did he have? Why did he have to bleed so much?
But there is a genuine storyline to it. But it would you'd be completely forgiven for not knowing it because it actually originated on a Ring of Honor pay per view.
Okay.
So there was a match between, I think maybe it was Best Friends and someone else.
It was a four-way. It was a four-team tag match between Best Friends, Aussie Open, Lucha Bros, and a fourth team who escaped me.
And Mox interfered anyone. He basically laid out, like really viciously laid out Orange Cassidy. And then obviously they had the thing and at All In with the Stadium Stampede with Cassidy and them.
But and the BCC has been targeting Best Friends really hard the last few weeks.
Yeah, but again, you'd be forgiven for not following that just because part of it did sort of originate on Ring of Honor. Not everybody watches Ring of Honor.
And also, this is a match where they had to I think this is one of those rare matches where the loser comes out looking better.
And he did. And he did.
And here's the kind of story of Orange Cassidy, though. It comes out, he's originally the slacker who comes in, and he's made he's defended that championship against some of the biggest stars in AEW, and somehow come out of it. And it makes a story of, yeah, Orange Cassidy finally lost the belt, but it was only after 30-something defenses, him working through multiple injuries, we had to get John Moxley, who is the ace of AEW and probably the most well-protected star they have. And even Mox struggled to beat Orange Cassidy. He had to bloody him up something fierce. And only then could he just about get the victory on Orange Cassidy. That's a star-making performance of Orange Cassidy. They had to make him bleed so much to show we have to rip it out of his bare hands to get that title off him.
So were you guys happy with that being the main event then?
Oh, God, yeah. That was Orange moment.
Yeah, I was happy with that as a main event. Partly because it's Orange, like it's the elevation of Orange Cassidy to the top level. And partly because it's the elevation of that title. So I think what they're doing is that's going to become kind of Collision's kind of top title.
Okay.
I think Mox is going back into the indies for just do some more shows here and there. Like, he's definitely doing OTT in October, and I would highly suspect he'll be bringing the title there.
He's going to have that for a while. As a main event, I really liked it, and I would normally think that the world title should.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah,
this program with MJF and Adam Cole is so popular right now.
It's gold.
Didn't need to be the main event.
I think it devalues the title, though, does it not? Like, it's...
Nah, I don't...
You know, having your world champion there and him not defending the belt, it's... You know...
I think it's fair just because I think it would kind of value a little more if it was defended 2 weeks in a row when they've already been running with the idea of this is a title that's rarely defended, and when they do, it's a huge thing. It kind of feels weird to go from... It's defended as the main event of the biggest wrestling match in the history of wrestling. And then a week later, we're going to just suddenly rush a new program in to do another world title defense.
I think it comes down to the character of the champion as well. Like, it works with MJF. It wouldn't work with someone else. With someone like, if Jon Moxley was the world champion, you'd be like, yeah, what are you doing? Why aren't you out there defending the title at every opportunity? But when you have a character like MJF, whose whole thing is like, I will fight my contractually required dates, and that is it. You know, I think it kind of works for him.
Okay. Well, look, I mean, there are the questions I had going into it. So I'm going to hand this over to you, Martin, because this is your baby, and you know, myself and CJ will just give comments on this. So where do you want to go on this one?
Yeah, sure. Look, we'll run through. There's a good few matches, and like I say, we don't want to be here all night, so we'll run through them brave and quickly anyway. Better than New Bebe versus Dark Order. For me, like, Dark Order was never going to win. This wasn't so much about the match, which was a fun, it was a fun, 12, 15-minute match. Dark Order's pretty good back and forth, but like, they were never going to win. But it was never about that. It's all about furthering this story between Adam Cole and MJF, which I was, pretty happy about. What about yourselves?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Dark Order, particularly now that they're heel now. I think it really works well. They've really started to redeem themselves. They had a brilliant match with Ring of Honor against the... Stuben or whatever his name is, but I like the match. I think it's just a good way for Adam Cole and particularly MJF just to flex their face muscles a little bit, have some fun matches that they kind of don't really get to do in a world title sort of picture. And we all knew it's Dark Order weren't going to win, but it's just to give a good match and have some fun, and I really liked it.
Dara,
yeah, I mean. Again, I my thoughts on MJF. Adam Cole, it's great to see. I was happy when it was over.
Okay, I mean, that's fair enough, yeah. like I say, this is a fair criticism because I do this a lot with WWE because I don't watch the weekly show. So sometimes I don't get the full sort of emotional impact of a show on a pay-per-view. So like it'd be fair enough that if you were just watching this show expecting All Elite Wrestling, like the best in-ring wrestling.
That's what I was expecting.
Yeah, that's
the thing. Yeah.
Yeah. Next match, Samoa Joe defeated Shane Taylor by submission. This was a good match. Like, it was only 6 minutes, and Shane Taylor's, he's more of an ROH guy. He's not hugely known, but they're two big guys. They batted the hell out of each other. It was a good match, but the main thing was MJF was still holding his neck, still walking back up the ramp. When Samoa Joe decided, hit my music, and he walked down to the ring, and when he was walking past MJF, he just shoved him out of the way. So setting up a whole Samoa Joe MJF thing. Again, yeah, you could argue that, you know, maybe on a pay-per-view you shouldn't be having a match that's basically to start an angle, but I'm looking forward to MJF versus Samoa Joe. What do you think of this one, Dara?
Yeah, I mean, seeing Samoa Joe kill someone is always good. Like this was old school TNA Samoa Joe. Like he's done this before.
What is always... he on lately?
Oh man, it's like he stepped in a time machine and he's like, no, I'm going back to being peak Samoa Joe.
He's amazing lately.
But this is what he did. He had a similar run like this where he just killed everyone in the X Division for like a year. Literally just would just run through people. And it seems like that's kind of the run they're trying to give him here with this television title. Like it really does feel like that's the mold that they're working in. And look, no disrespect to Shane Taylor, but his job was there to get buried, and he got buried. But I would be very interested to see him with MJF to see like Joe getting that kind of match out of him. Because like physically, MJF and Punk had a lot in like. They worked well together, and I think like a big guy, small guy match would be very, very, very good. That's like Joe's big thing going all the way back. So yeah, if that's the next program that they're doing, damn, sign me up for that one, because a Samoa Joe right now, always a treat to watch.
CJ?
Yeah, I think same feeling that the opponent choice was kind of baffling at the start of like, of all last week of like a random match that maybe feels more in place on a Ring of Honor pay-per-view. But as soon as they kind of made it clear, this isn't so much about the match against Shane. This is about setting up that angle with MJF and making Joe look good again after eating the loss and all in. I think it definitely served a good purpose. And why Shane, of all people, got the match, I don't get. But hey, he got the match. He did a good job. We all love a bit of a... big meaty men slapping man meat, but that it sort of did that. But of course, we got that a little bit later into the night.
I think he got the match because he's like, right, I'll go out and take the pin. That's probably why he got the match.
Did Shane Taylor have any like connection to Chicago? Maybe that was it. But no,
it was set up on Ring of Honor. He won something on Ring of Honor, but again,
he's from Cleveland in Ohio.
It was something that was set up in Ring of Honor, but again, like I watch Ring of Honor weekly, very sporadically, because Tony, I would love to watch Ring of Honor, but I am not paying $9.99 a month to watch Ring of Honor.
I have to say though, right, he recently made his Impact debut like last year, and he lost against Crazy Steve, and Crazy Steve is not, you know, he's not a wrestling titan, so.
That guy's crazy.
And not to be confused with the Crazy Steve from Drake and Josh. This is a different Crazy Steve. Yeah, I mean, this guy was literally brought out to get battered for like 6 minutes and then get choked out. That's why he was there for. I think this was as close as you get to an enhancement match on a pay-per-view as you can. But I liked it. I thought it was great. I mean, again, lads, if he's haven't, and again, the listeners, if he's haven't seen Samoa Joe's run in TNA initially, this is what he did. Someone would show up in the X Division. He'd kill. This is where the Joe's going to kill you thing came from, right? He would run through them, destroy them, and everybody loved it. You know, sometimes you'd have a really good match that, you know, Joe would struggle with. Like the one that comes to mind now is Samoa Joe versus Sabu in a cage match. In lockdown a couple of years ago, But yeah, like, this is bread and butter Samoa Joe. This is like real Samoa Joe we're getting. So I'm okay with it.
Next match was Luchasaurus with the real TNT champion, Christian Cage.
Yeah, Christian Cage.
Against Darby Allin. My God. Like, whenever this match,
he's the best.
Whenever this match came on, I was like, God damn, this is it just me or is this pay-per-view cooking? This is awesome. Yeah. Luchasaurus versus Darby Allin on its own. That's a great match because Lucha, he's huge and he can hurl guys around and nobody gets hurled around like Darby Allin. That guy is determined to kill himself. He's absolutely determined to do it.
The amount of pain pills, he's going to be Jeff Hardy. Him and Jeff Hardy are going to be like, you know.
Ironically, he's straight edge.
Not for very much longer. I mean, things he does to his body.
He'll just get mad in the
pain pills.
Pepsi. no, man, this match was fantastic. Like, if you like a big man, small man setup matches, like, this was terrific. Darby is really pushing himself. Like, he's, I think they have something, like, obviously they're going with MJF and they've the whole thing with Adam Cole blow up and there's, you know, Orange Cassidy's out there, like really building his profile. But I think they have something big coming for Darby Allin down the
line. No, they do. And I'll tell you where this really kind of hit me as well. All In, there were like kids there dressed as Darby Allin.
Yeah.
You know,
and I mean, mad over.
Yeah, and I mean, once you have that level of investment, that's who you start pushing because they're the ones that buy the merch, you know. And like, again, he's like modern day Jeff Hardy, and I mean that not in a disparaging way. I mean it in like in a literal way. Like he cultivates the same fan base, the same group, is over with kids.
Yeah,
has a vendetta against his own body, you know. So I mean,
will be fans for life.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
and also he's also getting the alt crowd in. Like,
yeah, absolutely.
Remember seeing like there's a post on like I think Squared Circle just saying that listen, it's not that much of a secret in the manufacturing, the merch manufacturing scene that yeah, his shirts and merch sell really well at Hot Topic from alt.
Oh
girls,
yeah, I believe
who
it.
Just
yeah,
are
yeah.
really into him. Yeah. So yeah, he is.
As I said, he's the.
And I like
day.
Him also because he's willing to take a pin. He knows when losing. Really works well for you on your arc.
Yeah, he's a modern day Jeff Hardy, like literally in every conceivable way. And I mean, that works. This match, you know, it was cool. I again ending with Christian Cage, and I'm there for it. So,
well,
I love this match. Yeah,
I was just about to follow up that even if the match hadn't been great, Christian Cage is maybe the second best thing on AEW at the moment.
He is outstanding. Listen, he's one of the greatest talents that nobody knew about until recently. If there's one thing that I'm happy about AEW is that people finally know how great Christian Cage is. I've been screaming for 15 years longer. Yeah, 15 years about how great Christian Cage has been on TNA. And nobody was like, you're like, yeah, whatever. I'm like, no, go watch it. And now you get to see him redoing it on a bigger audience. And for that, I'm grateful. If Tony has done nothing else, is that he's allowed people see how great Christian Cage is.
Oh, this is...
And somehow managed to turn your father is dead into the biggest pop. Like, the fact there is so much. Like, remember when he was doing with Nick Wayne? Everyone just knew. It's like, Nick Wayne, I've heard a lot about you. I've heard a lot about your father. Crowd goes, oh, he's not. And your father, oh, is dead. Yay!
he's absolutely... masterful. Like, he's like, and Luchasaurus is he's a good wrestler. He's not like one of the top guys, but he's a good wrestler and he's a really imposing physical figure. But my God, and he's the one doing the wrestling, and Cage still outshines him. He is the TNT champion.
Oh, that, he is. That's he not even is, yeah.
That's not even a gimmick in his head anymore. Like, he's the champion. He's incredible.
Yeah, this is why, there are some betting sites doing betting on wrestling, which is weird to me, but still, I'm going to take advantage of that. A lot of them were pricing it as Darby as the favorite. And like statistically, yeah, you could probably argue that. No, it was still the best thing. I called it absolutely Luchasaurus is retaining because what's the story of Darby wins? okay, I guess he starts a new reign with no obvious feud to go into, or you keep it on Luchasaurus, and eventually, the whole point of the story is obviously Luchasaurus is going to start getting angry that Christian Cage is calling himself the real champ, and he's going to start, you know, building that sort of kind of that Batista angle of the bodyguard muscle, you know, builds a spine and stands up to that bastard heel manager. That's the entire point of this angle. And, you know, and you have to keep the championship on him to make that angle make sense.
And if there's anything we've learned from history, it's that when you rob a Burger King, you do your heroin at home. You don't do it in the restaurant.
What?
Martin, tell CJ the story, and listeners and fans that may not understand the TNA reference.
I am very confused.
So, who was it actually did the robbery?
Oh, it was one of Christian Cage's old floozies. Hold on, I'll look up his name.
But basically, he real life legitimately robbed a Burger King. I assume
Tomko. It was Tyson Tomko.
Tyson Tomko robbed Burger King. Armed robbery, I assume, because once he'd gotten his ill-gotten gains, he just sat down and had himself a nice bit of smack.
Right in there, the bathroom.
Right there in the bathroom of the Burger King that he was robbing while the police were on their way. He thought, if I'm going to jail, I'm going to jail with a smile.
And that's why Tomko isn't in AEW, and he's been replaced with Luchasaurus. So,
well, that's a phrase like when you gotta go. You gotta shoot up.
Look, if there's one thing they've learned from Orange Cassidy is, with the right person and the right title run, you can really elevate a title. So they took the international title from, yeah, it was kind of just another singles title they don't really need. To now, it's the second title in the company. The TNT title was that for a while, and then it really fell off. And I think,
thank you, Sarb. Thank you, Sammy Guevara and Scorpio Sky.
But I think a good long, I would keep it on Christian Cage for a long time, a good long Christian Cage run. Even when the feud comes to a head and he fights Luchasaurus for it, I'd have Christian Cage win.
Oh, yeah, man. He's one of the best things about professional wrestling. I would say he's better than Edge as far as, like, you know, his consistent character work. And in the ring, he always delivers as well. So,
here, you asked the question earlier, Dara, is Punk going to show up in WWE? And now I will rebut the question back to you. Is Edge going to show up on AEW?
Oh, I would say so, yeah. I think that makes sense. But where and why would be a better question. I mean, I don't think he'll be there as Christian's tag team partner. They'll probably do some sort of feud, or, you know, I think, look, AEW needs that kind of star for Collision. So I'd see probably Edge. Yeah, I'd see Edge probably up on Collision, up the top of the card.
And that's Collision is the one that's on TNT, Dynamite's on TBS now. So
yeah. So I mean, that's where I see him going, if he is going. Like, obviously they'll do something with Christian eventually when he becomes a face. Because right now, I don't think Edge wants to go into that when he's screaming about his people's dads being dead. So like
Adams and Edge's dad, I think he says before, like, he never knew his father. So
yeah,
it's kind of hard for Christian Cage. And based on your age, statistically speaking, your father is, statistically speaking, probably dead.
No, Christian Cage goes, Edge, I know you're estranged from your father, but guess what? I have him here tonight. And he comes out on stage, and then Christian,
with a coffin.
And then Christian just shoots up. He's like, your dad's dead.
I think it would work if, like, Edge does come back as the face. And it's just the two never acknowledge each other, never face each other on stage until Edge's last feud. Like, this is, like,
the
last
one. Because he said before. That's genuinely, like, what I see, yeah.
Yeah, and it has to be Christian and Edge saying, we need to figure out who's better.
Yeah, and I think that is probably what they do. That's the smart thing to do. Let Edge have his own run Again, look, again, they need a star on Collision. They really do. And throw him in there with Daniel Bryan, and you have your first program right out of the gate. Like,
next match was
the debut of Lana.
Slapping man meat.
The debut of Lana. That's what we had next.
Never mind Lana. We got meat. I lost my whole off
meat.
Just the constant meat forever chance.
Wait, hold on a minute. I didn't realize. What's your man's name? Stansasia came back. What's going on?
I was hoping you wouldn't be able to think of his name.
Sean Stasiak, the return of meat. Is he all elite now?
all meat.
All meat.
So,
but like Miro... the best part, yeah. So best part to me, anyway, of that Lana debut was every time she was looking at one of the wrestlers, whether it was Miro or Powerhouse, the crowd just chanted beat that meat over and over again. Oh, God.
Miro comes out to defeat Powerhouse Hobbs. This was an awesome, just huge guys beating the hell out of each other match. But what really got this match over for me was it was kind of the theme of the night. It was guys getting over in defeat. It was somebody getting over and somebody going over. This happened the whole way through the night. So Miro won the match. But the way the two had been absolutely battering each other, it could have gone either way. And Powerhouse Hobbs, despite losing, came out of it looking even stronger, which is the same thing happens later on with Ricky Starks, and the same thing happens again with Orange Cassidy. So guys coming out looking stronger in defeat seemed to be something of a theme of this match. But I sense that you lads are more keen to talk about the ending of the match, which we had the return of Hot and Flexible Lana,
also known as CJ Perry, which I think is a wonderful. Here's the thing, right? I'm just gonna say this: AEW can have this for free, right? Power couple, CJ Perry, manager of CJ Polacco.
They could do a whole Jeff Jarrett double CJ.
Exactly. They can do a whole thing. It writes itself. And Miro, because it's already been set up in as Rusev, right? You can have CJ Polacco cheating on Miro, Miro being cheated on, basically. And they just do, instead of Bobby Lashley, it's CJ Polacco. And he goes, what? They had the same name as me. And then there you go. That's what I would do.
Well, at the end of the match, so CJ Perry came out, sort of give Miro the edge to win, but Miro couldn't bring himself to embrace her because he still doesn't think he deserves his misses because he hasn't got a title yet. And I'm really intrigued by that, to see where that leads in terms of the story with Miro. Anyway, Daria, go ahead.
And that wasn't quite how it ended. I think Miro did defeat Powerhouse Hobbs fairly. Yeah. And then the match, Hobbs came out and started beating the crap out of him.
Yeah.
And then Lana came out for the save.
Yeah.
With the chair shot.
Then Miro just, like I say, like does just screaming, "You're not real. You're not real." I think that was a really nice touch.
Apologies. That was what happened. Overall thoughts in the match, CJ?
I loved it. I think that's one thing that AEW's kind of been missing out on, was the whole big meat slapping man meat. I think AEW's kind of been missing that. Meanwhile, WWE has been killing it with Gunther, Sheamus, Drew McIntyre, that scene.
Yeah.
So I think, AEW embraced the meat. Because guess what? We love it.
Dara?
Yeah. I mean, I think that kind of sums it up. It's like, wrestling is a three ring circus, you know, and you need to kind of have all the different things represented. AEW is still kind of bottom heavy, with its, you know, flippy dippy nonsense, for the most part, particularly on the Dynamite side. But I think moving more towards, like, you can have this mellow sports entertainment kind of thing. You can have this as well, and it sits nicely in the mid card, which is exactly where this was. Bringing Lana out, it's cool because it's like, oh yeah, grand, right? You have some sort of debut. It's something to get the fans popped, but also it gives Miro now a different dynamic that he can work on. He's not just unstoppable. It's like he's dealing with this extra layer that they can go into as well. So I mean, look, this is only good for AEW. It what I will say is they need to be careful they don't go into the WCW thing where it's like, let's hire all ex-WWE guys, because that's also bad. But doing it for the right reasons and doing it in a creative way absolutely makes sense. And it did not make sense to have Lana on TV without Rusev. It does not really make sense having Miro on TV without CJ Perry. And it makes even less sense not having CJ Polacco there.
Up next was Chris Statlander defending her TBS title against Ruby Soho. Again, this was a match that didn't have a whole pile of build. I'm kind of willing to forgive that because it's so early in Statlander's TBS run.
Yeah.
And I hope they're just getting a couple of wins out of the way and then they'll start building up stories and stuff with her.
I would heavily disagree with that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you remember at the start of Ruby Soho's heel turn, she mentioned a crowd in Las Vegas that booed her out of the building? Remember who that crowd was or what that match was? Her versus Chris Statlander. And extra layer of why I love this match so much, because I was there. Las Vegas. There was a rampage. And like, I was baffled. Like, I love Ruby Soho. And like, but the crowd was so behind Chris. They were furious Ruby won. And like, you could see Ruby, she was going into the heel tactics midway through the match because she realized I'm unwittingly the heel. And like, Ruby went over the end because obviously they had set up it's Ruby versus Britt at Double or Nothing.
Mm.
But that it definitely set that up of Chris has never beaten Ruby one-on-one, despite the fact they'd fought maybe once or twice before that. And that match really set something off in Ruby that would turn her towards her heel turn. So it made sense that now that Chris has gotten her title, Ruby is going to target her and is going to destroy her, because Ruby knows she can in her mind to just rip that title away from Chris. And it was also the perfect opportunity to show the Outcasts are officially done. Thank Christ for it.
I actually wasn't aware of that, but I loved the angle with the Outcasts at the end of this, where Tony Storm came out and whipped the paint away from Saraya.
Should have been a shoot.
This Tony Storm character is amazing. Like, it's right up there with the best things that AEW are doing at the moment. So I like the match. It was a good story in that. I like the development with the Outcast. The actual 12 minutes of the match were good, not mind-blowing. Dara, what did you think?
Yeah, I mean, the women's division is usually very hit and miss in AEW. Like, it usually is either something that's great or they completely miss the mark. I think this time around, as you said, like, I'm giving this a lot of slack because it is so early on. I really like both Ruby Soho and Statlander, so I was happy to see them out. They had a decent match. It wasn't the best match I've ever seen, but it made sense given that in All In they had really what was a much bigger moment for the women's division.
CJ, and you wanna add?
Yeah, I will agree that the women's division definitely does need a lot more love in AEW. I do really like Chris's run because it felt like the last few months since Thunder Rose is gone, it's always kind of centered around Britt Baker and the Outcast. Like, if there was a women match, it would always revolve around them. It feels like Chris, she's taken and said, nope, you're not doing that anymore. She's putting random women on Dynamite. Like, she's put Emi Sakura on Dynamite, matches with the Bunny and stuff like that. And I just think, yes, you have all these female talents, bring them out. Please bring back the Bunny. Bring back Abaddon. Bring back Penelope Ford. She's ready to come back. We need to sing this back. But yeah, I like that Chris is starting to force them to revolutionize, whether they like it or not.
Hmm.
Dara, you said that this wasn't the best match you've ever seen. The next match might very well have been, though. Bryan Danielson versus Ricky Starks in a strap match. I mean,
with a broken freaking arm.
Well, no.
The best match you've ever seen? Was it the most violent match you've ever seen? Was it just the most blatant display of like cooperative lunacy between two people you've ever seen?
Well, we've talked about our fondness of strap matches. You know,
yeah,
they're very hard to do, but when they're done well, they're done incredibly well. There's a reason why they do them, because you know you do. Look, I think this was more effective than what Moxley was doing. You know, basically most of the things that he does, I think it's more effective than glass. It's like real glass. It's more effective than
cry me a river.
Fire. It's more effective than barbed wire. And the reason why is because you can hit someone with a strap and the welts, which it's like
you can't fake that.
You can't fake it, but it also looks quite well. Like, you know, when someone's bleeding all over the place, the effect is kind of lost after a certain point of time, you know? But with this, it's like that, like again with kendo sticks, when you hit them with it, it's like, damn, that looks bad. You know, it looks like they've been through war, even if it's, you know, less bad than something else. Still doesn't seem like a fun time. Still crazy to go, let's hit each other with straps for 17 minutes. You know, that's insane. But, I mean, I think for what you would expect from their biggest show of the year, at least one of the biggest shows of the year, this is a match that delivered in every conceivable way. Not the best match of all time. I still think Daniel Bryan is a B-plus player. But, you know...
This blasphemy.
Look, Triple H said it wasn't wrong. It is what it is, but it was still good. I think the ball had fun out there.
I think what really did it for me was like even if you remove the gimmick of the strap, which you say is so difficult to work with, like it can get so easily tangled up or come loose, or there's a whole dynamic to it alone, kind of similar to the dog collar matches. So even without the strap, this was a great match, but my God, they utilized that thing so perfectly. So you hear those cracks, right? And like everything has a diminishing return, and they're fully aware of this. So you heard those first few cracks and oh my God, you could feel that in your body. And you know, you get the next few and you're like, oh God, that'd be awful, but it's not quite the same. But then Bryan Danielson spins Ricky Starks around and starts belting him again in the chest. You're like, oh, it's escalated again. It's back up top there. You're feeling every one of them again. And then towards the end, he starts just belting him in the face with the goddamn thing.
That like was ridiculously violent.
It was they knew the diminishing returns, you know, of the belt with the strap. But my God, they worked around that so perfectly, and it built up the whole way through the match. And then to finish them off in the submission with the strap, and to have Ricky Starks pass out, put Bryan Danielson over as the absolute killer he is, put Ricky Starks over as like this is a guy who has really stepped up. Thought this match was a triumph. CJ, what were your views on it?
Well, first of all, I want to say in our regards to Justin Roberts, who had PTSD flashbacks watching the ending.
That's a good
But yeah, that was, I think it was great that they did this match, because obviously Ricky, he could have been really screwed over by Punk. No, he could have gone from having the main event with Punk to potentially could have gone to nothing, missing All In and All Out. That would have sucked. And props to Bryan Danielson for finding a way to do the match, because I think he even said there was a lot of smoke and mirrors for that match for him to be able to do it. But they really pulled it through. They made an incredibly brutal match. And I love me a brutal match like that from time to time. I love seeing like Bryan Danielson in full on killer mode. Like when you get that look in his face of, I am going to kill you. Like obviously with John Moxley, you know, he's more of a brawler type. He always has that feel. But when Bryan Danielson does it, he goes from, yeah, I'm just here to screw with you, I'm just here because I can play with you, to I'm going to kill you mode. That is terrifying, and I love it.
So there's two matches here that I'm going to kind of combine, because they were both very good matches. I really enjoyed them. I really like all the people who are involved. But for whatever reason, they just kind of felt surplus to me. They kind of felt like they could have been kept for Dynamite or for Collision. So it was the Blackpool Combat Club tag team match with Eddie Kingston and Shibata. Mm. And the Bullet Club Gold 8-man match with them and FTR and the Young Bucks.
Yeah.
Like I said, maybe I'm alone in this. I thought they were both excellent matches. Like when I was sat up watching them, I was well into them. But I don't know what it was. They just looking back on them.
Yeah, the matchups feel like it's just like multi-group tag matches. It does kind of scream random Dynamite to me.
I'm amazing
matches, but and I do think it really worked for Eddie Kingston setting up that flute feud with Cassinelli repeating that.
Brilliant,
up.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Like I said, when I was watching them, absolutely loved them, but yeah, maybe it was just all in kind of burnt me out a wee bit on multi-mans. Dara, what's your take?
I mean, I think I said it matches very much what I said about the similar thing at All In. It's like, I just, whatever it is about these multi-man matches, I'm just not a fan of them. I think there's obviously, look, all the lads need to get paid. You know, the money mark needs to give his money out to people. So, I mean, that's why they do them. You know, everyone needs to get paid. And that's just what it is. They don't serve a purpose. I mean, like, fair enough. The tag team match, okay.
Well, you still need to do it a little bit. You still need to heat up the Kingston Cassinelli feud.
And that was totally okay.
And Bullet Club Gold, I'm really happy that they got two wins in a row.
I know, but the thing about it is, it's like what I would have rathered, one or the other. You know, if you're going to have this is why I don't like Survivor Series, because it is all just ridiculous multi-man tag team matches, because it's like I would have rather have seen a straight tag team match with any of the lads, if I'm Bullet Club Gold, FTR or the Bucks. I would have rather that. I know they did it last week, but I think this was a case of all the lads need to get paid. That's all this was. Nothing more, nothing less.
I don't think it was all the lads need to get paid. I think it was all the lads need to be on the show, because Bullet Club Gold are, you know, they're, like you said, they're going through this. They're really hot right now. Like I say, I enjoyed the matches while they were happening. Maybe I'm a wee bit burnt out in the multi-mans. Maybe it was just that I felt that there were good developments there with Bullet Club Gold and with Kingston and Cassagnoli, but they were kind of lost in the mix, given that there was so much else happening on this card.
It was a little hard to get excited for them.
Yeah, like, especially when you knew what was coming up next was Konosuke Takeshita versus Kenny.
Yes.
My God, Omega. CJ, what do you think?
Oh, I like it. I do. I'm not the biggest New Japan fan, but I do love it when they break one of those sort of matches out in AEW. And this was absolutely a New Japan match of just a Japanese strong style and just the best bout machine. I love the match. It was damn good. And I was surprised by the result. I was expecting, you know, listen, Takeshita will come out looking really strong, but Kenny, he's been eating a lot of pins recently. He needs to get that sort of comeback, because I don't think he's that coming up sort of babyface. He's a super strong babyface to me. But no, they want to give Takeshita that push, and fair enough, Omega is willing to give that to him.
I think there's a story building there with Omega. You know, maybe a kind of a Hangman Page style loss of confidence type thing.
Because
not only did Takeshita win, like there was a wee bit of Don Callis shenanigans towards the end, but Takeshita's actual win, the sort of finishing sequence and the movie put him away with, it was clean, and it was in the middle of the ring. It was a hell of a win for Takeshita. Sensational match. I think you called it perfectly there, that it was It was a real, like, straight up New Japan style match. But Dara, I'm interested to get your take on it, because we don't always have the same views on Kenny Omega or these type of matches. What do you think?
So I like New Japan style matches. What does Jim Cornette call them? Twinkle Toes?
Kenny Olivier, I think he calls.
Yeah, I don't like him. I don't like Kenny Omega. The more I watch Kenny Omega, the less I like Kenny Omega. And I know that's unpopular. I can tell that you guys are like, what are you talking about? I don't know what it is.
Not even that it's like people like what they like.
Let me get my little voodoo doll.
I don't know what it is. I mean the match itself was quite good. It was very good. It was actually incredible. It was a really, really good match. It was a New Japan match done in AEW. But and also having Don Callis out there, I mean, Don Callis is great. Like, anything with Don Callis is always going to be good. But
the fact that the brown note is his entrance music.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's fantastic. But with Omega, I don't know. I was glad to see him lose. And I actively boo him. But again, I mean, he's half the reason Punk isn't there. So I'm also like going to carry that as well. So as a wrestler, I don't like him, and as what he did to Punk, I don't like him either. So
nah, Punk's gone because of Punk's action.
I know. But
also, Kenny and Punk sell the beef.
They did. But it's just been a bad seeing him so close. I think they should have maybe put a mask on him.
I'm always really intrigued by people's perspectives on Omega, particularly when they don't like him, because I get that he is polarizing. Like, there's like I understand, I acknowledge that there are a lot of people who don't like him, but I cannot for the life of me fathom it, because for 30 years, like, I always thought, like, the question of my favorite movie is settled. It is has and forever will be Ace Ventura. Yeah. My favorite band is, has, and forever will be the Pogues. And I had thought that my favorite wrestler is, and forever will be Bret Hart. But my God, the past couple of years, I'm telling you, it's neck and neck between the two of them. Like, I think he's incredible.
I think they both revolutionized wrestling in their own era. Bret obviously was a technical mastermind, and Kenny just taught differently of wrestling, of how you can tell a story within the match, of what sort of moves you could pull, how you could combine all these different wrestling moves and the long-term stories you could tell with it. That's Kenny's draw.
I just don't see him as a draw. I don't know what it is.
How many Tokyo Domes he's packed out?
I know, but if you went, if you went to WWE, I think he'd fail.
They probably set him up to fail.
No, I mean, like, a star should draw everywhere, you know? And New Japan, fair enough, but I don't think he has the vibe. Like, doing a direct comparison between him and Finn Balor, for example, like, Finn draws. You know, Finn has a character that, you know, can work anywhere. Kenny, his character is to how good of a wrestler he is, which, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and say he's not a good wrestler. He's absolutely incredible. The matches he does is great, but I don't know. It's just when you see Kenny Omega, I'm like, ugh. You're like, okay, if Kenny Omega was walking down the street, I'd be like, yeah, whatever. You know?
Oh, my God. If Kenny Omega was walking down the street and your reaction wasn't to immediately call me and tell me,
I would kill you.
No, but I mean, like, I just don't see him as a star. You know, I honest to God don't. I just see him as,
like, I think it maybe,
you know, I don't know. I don't know what it is. I think
it maybe comes down to, like, what you look for in a wrestler. So, like, when I look at my favorite wrestlers, they're all guys who were incredible wrestlers. Like, it's Bret Hart, it's Kenny Omega, it's Bryan Danielson. They're all guys who are...
See, I don't see Daniel Bryan as a star either. I'm just like, if he's walking the street, I'm like, oh, yeah, whatever. You know?
See, that's probably it. It's
that's probably what it is. Different
styles.
Here's what I think it is that I think... I think you prefer wrestlers there where they can really sell a match to you, really make you care about it.
Yeah, that
the match itself maybe isn't the most crazy technical, could just be a standard WWE brawl, but you'd still be happy with it. Meanwhile, me and Martin, we're all about the in-ring action. The build and that could be terrible, but I would love the match itself.
And I think that could be it. And like,
as I said, like, the hardest thing about this show really was, all joking aside, the hardest thing was, like, the build. You know, there was no, like, big video package. There was no, you know what I mean? Like, there was, for want of a better word, the WWE packaging of it wasn't there, you know? And because you're just, like, when you're watching the matches, and when you're watching, look, this is a phenomenal pay-per-view. When you're watching it, you're having a great time. But when you're breaking down, you're like, oh, you know what I mean? It's like,
yeah, yeah. Like, again, it's,
yeah, fair,
it's,
yeah,
it's just whatever you stylistically prefer. Like, I think no one would argue that, like, the biggest or most recognizable active wrestler in the world right now is Roman Reigns.
Mm.
Just does absolutely nothing for me, but he clearly does for millions of people. So it's, you know, it's just a stylistic thing.
Yeah, I think it is just the kind of case of, oh, you know what it probably is, right? To kind of boil this down into one thought. WWE style sports entertainers, wrestlers, are stars inside and outside the ring. As far as, like, the inside doesn't matter. Look at Bray Wyatt, right? Bray Wyatt wasn't my favorite wrestler, right? Awful in the ring. Genuinely terrible, right? Genuinely probably one of the worst wrestlers to get to that point. It didn't matter. He was still a star, right? Kenny Omega, when he gets in that ring, he's probably better than anybody there, right? Genuinely, right? But once he walks outside the ring, he's probably going to be at a Comic-Con. You know what I mean? It's like some guy at a Comic-Con who you're like, dude, can I read the comics there? Can I just get past you there for a minute? That's what Omega is for me, you know? Because I'm like, oh, he's great in the ring, but then he gets out. It's kind of like, you know, the lad that you train with who's awesome. And you're like, oh, great. But then you go out and have beers with him afterwards. You wouldn't have a beer with Bray Wyatt because he's the Fiend. You know what I mean? That kind of thing, you know, and that's the disconnect. That for me.
Anyway, so before, when we started this, Dara, you had a lot of questions about kind of the how and the why of the main event, which was Jon Moxley versus Orange Cassidy.
Many hows and whys.
We went over that.
Yes.
What did you think of the actual main event itself then as a match?
I was shocked that I cared about Orange Cassidy, not as a joke. He's gas as a meme, you know? And, like, I mean, your flag all in was hilarious. And just the whole, like, initial pull of... Orange Cassidy is a star, right? he is. Like, that's what I mean. Like, Omega isn't, but he is. And I think... I don't really know why either. It's just like, it transcends the ring. He doesn't have to wrestle. He's Orange Cassidy, you know? But the fact that he did in this match and was basically crucified by Jon Moxley, it's unbelievable. It's a star-making performance. It's like, I never saw Orange Cassidy as a main eventer, but I do now. And I think that's incredible.
CJ, you give a fairly impassioned defense of the building and the booking of this match at the start of the podcast. What do you think of the actual match itself, bell to bell?
I thought it was brilliant. I thought it is Orange Cassidy. At the start, he tries to do his usual of psyching out his opponent, no hands in the pockets, sunglasses on. Jon Moxley, that's just not going to work. But he's still, even in total exhaustion, he still managed to break it out to try and screw with Mox. I think it even works a little better when Mox is just exhausted. They both pinch hell, and Mox just looks up. You're still trying to get in my head. Well, it worked. He still lost got pretty damn angry at him. Damn, did it. I just some amazing shots in this match. Like, just the opening shot of just Orange Cassidy's taped up fists staring at Mox. Just so you can see the damage from this long reign he's had. And he's about ready to break. But damn, he ain't going without a fight.
So, I think this match, for me, it kind of illustrates a lot about how AEW does its storytelling. So people say, oh, AEW doesn't do storytelling. It completely does. But it does it differently. It doesn't necessarily do it with, you know, big long promos or love triangles or whatever. This is a story that they've been telling for 3 years now, and it's been told almost exclusively in the ring.
Yeah.
And you've seen Orange Cassidy go from the couldn't care less slacker to the guy who slacks, but he can actually go to getting a title, to getting a taste of that gold, and really like over 31 defenses, really starting to care before coming up against a brick wall, John Moxley, and losing, but coming out. So we came out on Dynamite there on Wednesday, and he said, you know, they told me after the match at the weekend, and it's so unusual to hear Orange Cassidy speaking at all. They told me not to show up, and I told them I'm coming to work, and I'll be here every week from now on. So I think it's this kind of illustrates the type of storytelling AEW do, in that a lot of it is told in the ring.
Mm. Yeah, the fact that, as I said again, that he had such a long tirade, he defended against absolute giants in the company. They had to get the absolute ace of the company, the only man with like 100 wins in the company, to beat him.
Absolutely. Look, as a match, I thought it was excellent. I mean, it's Moxley and Orange Cassidy. It's two of the best wrestlers in the world. Lads, if you were going to give the pay-per-view a score overall, CJ, what would you say?
Out of 10, definitely a 9.
Dara, you can do numbers or grading or whatever you
In honor of Daniel Bryan, I'm going to give it a solid B+.
Fair enough. Yeah, I'd give it an A. I'd give it a 9. I thought it was fantastic. But again, a lot of that for me was down to the vibe, how it felt different, how it felt like the kind of AEW, I was about to say the AEW that I grew up with, the AEW that sort of came out in 2019, 2020.
Yeah.
So I'd give it that A, but I would make the distinction between, you know, what's the best and what's my favorite. Dara, I've run through All Out, so I'm now going to hand control, graciously cede power back to your good self.
Thank you. And there you go. Because, I mean, there's no point in me running through it and then, you know, skipping everything when I have the two biggest AEW fans I know on the podcast. So I wanted to give you guys the moment, because I do kind of have a habit of like running through stuff. It's like, no, we're going to go back.
You missed this wrist lock here, and let me explain for 5 minutes why this wrist lock is actually very important.
So I figured I'd be like, no, I'll let you guys go for it. So thank you, Martin. All right. So guys, that's going to be it for this week here on the Wrestling Rewind. Again, thank you so much for everyone who listened in and follows over on the podcast. If this is your first show, please go over to WrestlingRewind.com, the True Penny channel, and subscribe. Let people know about the podcast. Give us an X-Pac Euro. And of course, if you want to be on the podcast as well, you're more than welcome. But CJ, I want to thank you for being on the show, man. Again, you do all the music stuff. You're not only in Horrenda, but you're also in EYES ETERNAL, which are is sick. I know you've been doing some PR on that as well. So if you want to tell the people about it, go for it, sir. Where can people find you?
Okay, well, EYES ETERNAL, it's a one-man studio project. I only tag that works for this kind of extreme prog metal. If you like bands like Nebu Ascaris, Emperor, or stuff, Rivers of Nile, you'll like EYES ETERNAL. Yep, find us all the usual socials. Get our EP Bloodstained Wings now. I'm trying to get back into Twitch once life calms down a bit. Also in this band called HORRENDA. Maybe you've heard of it, Dara. Maybe you haven't.
Maybe.
And we're going to do some exciting stuff coming forward soon. That's all I will say.
Are you on Twitter?
Yeah, I am on Twitter. Frody Jr., FRODIJR, because no one knows how to spell it.
That's a good
See
point.
My that terrible wrestling takes.
I like it. So yeah, go over, follow both the bands and CJ on Twitter as well. Martin, is there anything you want to plug as the real world champion?
No, Dara. I'm telling you, this podcast and Without a Pint has me much less inclined to say ridiculous things.
Actually, I have something that to plug before we leave, Martin, a recommendation of sorts. So we're known as, like, you know, you got me onto Hades, right?
Oh yeah.
So Hades is phenomenal. There's a game that's not totally different, but very similar in lots of ways. Graphically wise, it's apples and oranges, but it is very much kind of a pick up and play kind of thing and see how far you can get. It's called Vampire Survivors. I think it's like €2 or something.
Oh,
like that. Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen it. So it's worth.
Oh man, I'm obsessed with it. I'm obsessed with it. It's actually fantastic. And for anyone who maybe picked up Hades because we recommended it, which you totally should, pick up Vampire Survivors because that is equally as fun.
Oh, do you know what? That's actually perfect timing because I don't know if I've talked about it on the podcast before, but I have been absolutely burning through Doom and Doom Eternal.
Yeah.
Just glorious, glorious games. But yeah, I'm coming towards the end of that now, so I'll give that a go next. Thanks a million.
No worries. And guys, again, thank you so much for checking out the show. We'll be back next week. I think we're going back in your house, Art.
Back out of this modern crap.
Back into the
glory days of the mid-90s.
Oh, brilliant. Well, guys, we'll be back next week to talk more wrestling nonsense from the past. I've been Darragh Connor for Cormac Jordan and Matt Hardy. See you next week here on Wrestling Room. Bye, guys.
See you more left.
Thank you for listening to a Nerd to Know Media production.